What everyone was waiting for was the lightsaber duel. When that's up there on the screen, you're caught up in the drama of it. You're not thinking about how it was made. It truly is mind-boggling how many people, how many thousands of hours it takes to make just one sequence. A sequence that's over virtually within a minute. An interesting experiment is to actually take a sequence of shots, maybe less than a minute, and analyze how many people were involved in the making of that sequence. Just as extraordinary how one little scene can involve so many different people. Within this brief moment of the film, you really have a window into the entire process of what it took to make episode 3. As the producer, my job is to assemble the team of artists and technicians who will bring George's total vision to life. My job is to enable him to make sure that he has everything he needs to express himself. That's all a producer can ever expect to do. It's thousands of people coming together for one very intense period of time. And when it works, it's absolute magic. And it all starts with the screenplay. Every single movie begins with an idea, one that's turned into a screenplay. It's the virtual blueprint for the entire project. George's script for Revenge of the Sith ran about 120 pages. The duel on Mustafar took up just 3 or 4 of those pages. Even those few pages took George a few weeks to write.
In the process of writing the script, I had to come up with what do they do on this planet? Why is it there? What is the base that is there that they're actually working out of?
He knew the lightsaber duel was the turning point in the entire movie, in many ways of the entire Star Wars saga. There were just a few pages, but getting them right was extremely tough. Getting them on screen was even tougher. The concept artists create designs for every single planet, spaceship, creature, weapon, and environment. George reviews these designs and selects the ones that will appear in the movie.
What do you want me to do? You want me to pull out the ones I like, or you want me to...
Yeah, places. Eric Timmons and Ryan Church are in charge of the whole group of artists who brought the planet of Mustafar off the page. What you see on the screen begins with them.
So there's a whole history. This has been in George's mind for a long time, this idea of the lava planet. And Ralph McQuarrie did sketches of the Mustafar look, and many artists have worked on it. Doug Chang had done sketches and ideas. Mark Cabana. So there's been brainstorming in the past.
That's interesting too. These are good views. And again, we can sort of, you know, build a 360 degree and literally take those and try to string them together and see if you can figure out how they would fit together.
Okay. George has always been a really great master weaver. He can take 50 different threads and make them together into one movie, but we want to provide him with 10,000, not 50. Yeah.
And basically we were here to provide George with variations on a theme, putting them out on boards, and then getting his feedback for honing the look in.
Now we hit your lava world. I mean, obviously that's another thing, but these are kind of in that Mufasa realm, just kind of looking for...
Yeah, that's starting to look good. Yeah. It's hard to get one person to do two different planets because it all comes out looking the same. That's always been a problem we've had, of trying to get the variety of design that we need.
Quite sure about that.
You have disappointments when your thing doesn't get picked or whatever, but there's always a really good reason for your image not being picked. And it could be something as basic as, this is great, you know, George says this all the time, this is great, not for my movie, but this is great, you know. It just doesn't fit into the story that we're telling.
But I mean, that's what we gotta be careful of. I mean, we gotta make sure that it's very distinctive so that we can, you know, instantly sort of look, and I say you have to be able to look in a couple of seconds and say, okay, I know where I am, I know what that is. And
we would go through various designs. I mean, this would go over a period of months while I was writing the script. So I would rewrite the script as I was beginning to see the environment and what I had to work with to design the sequence. There you go. A first draft. Official first draft. Of course, there's a lot of cheating in there. A lot of they fight. For 20 minutes, and it's just says they fight. I'm bringing in a guest director.
Can you say, or is it a secret?
Well, we'll see. You'll see next week, because he'll be here next week. Steven Spielberg was helping me with the previs, and I was always throwing all of the weight of the problems onto Steven by saying, well, the director wants this, and the director wants that. And, you know, whenever there was something that was going to cause trouble for somebody, I just blame it on Steven, because if I said I wanted this, and they'd start to argue about it, but I just say Steve wants this, and then they wouldn't moan and groan quite as much.
Our director's come up with a really good idea.
Oh, yeah?
Which I think we'll probably use. I'm not quite sure how we're going to do this, but what he wants to do, probably here is one of the best places, if they get down to the end and it breaks off so that it goes and it lands in a river of lava, and they're on it. But he wanted to do something, you know, sort of up in here somewhere, where, you know, one of those big spurts go up, and they jump under a ledge, and the whole thing sort of rains next to them.
Yeah.
You know, so you'd shoot them, and then you had this whole screen of embers and stuff flying down and bouncing off and catching on fire.
That's a nice little
route. Yeah. That's why I hired him.
This one.
For God's sake, the guy's good.
So I was thinking that the lava geyser would happen here, and then Obi-Wan comes down, Anakin gives chase. We were trying to think of something that would cause the arm to break, but if it, so we can have some boards to suggest the lava is melting through. Maybe the lava is breaking the cables, or
yeah,
it could be a combination.
All right, yeah, no, that'll work.
Okay, great. So all this stuff will be going back down to Ben, and the next time you see it, it'll be cut and in color.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Episode 3!
Using computer technology, the previs department takes the art department's designs and creates this living storyboard.
We take actual art from the art department, we take storyboards from the art department, and then we kind of mix and match them all together along with live action stuff. We basically build everything in 3D, we texture it, we light it, we go through every step that ILM would go through, only we do it in a more fundamental, basic kind of manner so that it's easy and fast and flexible, so that when George comes upstairs or he's editing, you know, he could say, you know what, I've got this idea, I want this shot that I just thought of it. And in a half a day or less, we could actually have a viable option for him to cut into the film to see if it works.
That's all you have to do.
As they would make Videomatic sequences, Ben Burtt would cut them together, and then as he cut them together, we would meet and say, well, we need more shots in here, and this is missing here, and we would go through the process of designing the shots that would need to go into the sequence.
We didn't really have them fenced with each other. They looked like two little action figures sliding along a floor. But the whole idea was to work out where they would go, where the fight would start, where they could go. A lot of the work that I do, especially in the pre-viz phase, is really just compiling a shopping list of here's an action sequence, here's 10 things that can happen, here's the way it might look. And George had a number of ideas, but what he really let us do was to just play with it.
There's still a lot of bits and pieces in here that are going to be, you know, lots of close-ups and more detail as they, you know, climb through as that thing's falling. And
it's very much similar to working on a set with actors. You know, they give you a performance. You know, you talk about what you want to have happen, and then they give you a performance, and you discuss, you know, what works and what doesn't work and where you want them to add or subtract. And then you do another take, and then you talk again, and you just keep going through it until you get it the way you want it.
At the most, you have maybe 24 shots
of the
environment.
Yeah.
That's it. And that's all there is. Yeah. Everything else is their head against a wall, or they're, you know, confined, or, you know, they're down there in the lava or anything, but you're never going to get back. You just don't get back very often,
right,
on any circumstances to see anything. So you got to make sure that those 24 times you actually get to get back and see something, you're really going to see something.
We have so much freedom to put into the story and the scenes that we create, a little bit of what we like in cinematography.
Occasionally they'll come up with an idea. Wouldn't it be great if you did this, or wouldn't it be great if you did that, or went around a corner if we did this? And, you know, and sometimes I take those ideas and sometimes I don't. But, you know, I encourage them to keep coming up with
interesting ideas as they work through these things. More than anything, we want to see the lava come up.
Exactly.
Yeah. We need to redesign the whole structure so that we can get these shots or whatever, wherever that is, to work. Pretty much around the time we start shooting the film, we've got a pretty tight version of what these action sequences look like. They're like storyboard sequences, only they move and they're in action and they're edited the way they're going to ultimately be edited in the movie.
Production, Nick speaking.
The production office in Sydney is the hub of it all, and we have a truly fantastic team.
Oh, sorry, I better just grab that.
Oh. Our production coordinator, Virginia Murray, is the one we go to with just about any issue, from actors' contracts to travel to insurance and equipment. She's the one who has all the answers.
We just have to find people who can really work together as a team and try and keep a happy office, because I think that's the main thing that was a big priority for this show, is because it just, I think that vibe can then filter through the whole of the crew if the production office is happy and helpful.
Darling, can you send Stewie down to see Rick in the production office?
Jackie Louay is my assistant and George's assistant. She keeps both of our schedules and makes sure that we know where we're supposed to be and what we're doing every single moment.
I don't want it to be over. I want it to last forever.
I'll let Stephen know.
Nick is our assistant coordinator. He is totally responsible for writing up the call sheets and making sure that everyone on the film, including every actor, shows up on time and knows exactly what it is that they need to do. Kate, the production secretary, is again someone who supports both Nick and Virg and makes sure that everything continues to run smoothly. And then there's Samantha, our production assistant, who really makes sure that we're taken care of. She makes sure that the line of communications are open between all of us. And then, of course, last but not least, is Stephen Jones, our production supervisor. And he is my partner in crime. He is responsible for making sure that everything that I ask for is on the set and ready to be used at a moment's notice for George. And at the end of the day, it's Kevin and Patrick Plummer who have the jobs that make them the most popular people in the production office. They're our movie's accountants, and they write the checks and get everyone paid.
I would actually say that without the accounting department, I mean, we're sort of the heart of the production. I mean, we're usually the first on and the last to leave.
My roles include supervising the payroll, looking after the accounts payable. I do all the petty cash, the per diems. It's a bit of a bank teller sort of job without the, you know, obvious money counters and stuff like that. But, and it's all balanced too, so that even surprised me.
Hundreds of people are on the movie set on any given day, and they all have one thing in common. They need to be fed.
A starving crew's here.
We have 5 hours to do food for 700, and there's about 20 of us, and today we've got a Thai theme going on. They can see that we're making an effort and they're treating us nicely, which is good. It makes us try harder for them, you know. They're on set for 12 hours a day. You know, half of the people we're feeding are construction. They just want to get the meat and potatoes in there.
Food is so important to keep not only the crew happy, but to make sure that everyone feels fulfilled enough, because they have to eat so quickly because we have so much work that we have to do during a 12 and 13 hour shooting period. The production design department oversees the plans for creating all of the sets on the movie. They're responsible for bringing the production out of the concept phase and into the real world. But at the moment, we haven't. Our production designer, Gavin Bouquet, his art directors, Ian Gracie and Phil Harvey, and supervising art director, Peter Russell, fill the enormous sound stages where the action will play out, including the massive lava collection arm where Anakin and Obi-Wan fight on Mustafar.
So we're presuming we're gonna need some, you know, a section of this and a section of that.
We analyzed where the actors came in most contact with the set itself, where they needed to be a part of the set and where they didn't.
To protect them from,
yeah. That's in the Videomatic.
Yes, no, we've got that.
Do we need to provide that set, as it were? Do we
like
elements
shaft
of it?
Yeah, I think, again, this is, I would say, this is the kind of thing that if you do build this little detailed piece here, then when we tilt it up and they have to climb up it. We could just use that same piece.
It's certainly a big end sequence. I don't think there's any doubt about that, isn't it?
Mustafar is a very engineered, hard-edged world. We were looking at architecture there that actually was based around sort of blast furnaces and very heavy industrial areas. But it wasn't necessarily specific to a period. It was more of an engineering type of look we were going for.
The construction department oversees the building of all the sets, and believe me, it's no small project. There's over 600 people in that department alone. A movie's construction crew can rival a major building project in size. It's enormous. There are carpenters who build the frames for the sets, riggers who hoist these enormous construction pieces, steel riggers who create the metal scaffoldings and skeletons, plasterers, molders, painters who finish off the sets and make them look real.
My job is construction manager. That would encompass putting a crew together, getting the plans into the office, getting those broken down. They go off to each different department, getting an idea of how all those different departments are going to work and how the hierarchy is going to be in each different department. The design of the sets in terms of how can we practically build this and how much is this going to cost, which is, of course, a great big part of it. Pretty much just coordinating, I guess, the whole thing.
What's sad and tragic to me is that the sets are so temporary. Each set will be torn down as soon as we finish shooting, often literally the same day. Every single item in a Star Wars movie has to be designed and built. The prop department creates all of this.
Basically, we literally have to make everything in-house. Set dressing, furniture, weapons, every sort of greebly, light switch, we do all of that. So it's pretty full on. I mean, that's why I end up with like 80 or 90 people working for me to get this job done.
There's one group of props that's particularly important to the Mustafar duel, and of course it's the lightsabers.
We have to do lightweight versions, heavyweight versions, rubber versions. There's all the different varieties of weapons.
Thomas Van Coverden crafted by hand each lightsaber, and they're absolutely exquisite pieces. It's not just about creating cool-looking weapons, though. It's about making props that actors love to use.
Ewan's favorite lightsaber. I try to get him to use other ones, but he knows that I'm trying to trick him. This time they're vacuum metalized. The advantage of the vacuum metalizing is that it just scratches rather than creating little chips or, you know, that would go into the actor's eyes. The heat shrink is also on the paint to not so much protect the paint, but protect any particles that may get airborne during combat. There's everything I need to supply them with all their fighting needs, basically.
We are free to actually make what we like at the end of the day, as long as it's within the realms of what we're trying to create on film. And it's fantastic. It's boys and their toys, you know, what can I say?
On so many movies, the hair and makeup artists make actors look beautiful and ravishing. Certainly that could be true in Star Wars movies, but in the case of the Mustafar duel, the hair and makeup group spent their time making Ewan and Hayden look hot, sweaty, and posing, and incredibly dramatic. With actors who are this good looking in real life,
it's gotta look rugged.
It wasn't necessarily an easy job.
There's a huge amount of pressure when I'm in front of Hayden and there's people like, you know, George saying, okay, you need to move the hairs three hairs that way, and you're sort of, there's 15 or 30, 40, 50 people looking at you while you're sort of standing there, everyone's waiting to roll the camera so you can, you know, get it right.
There's a lot of demands on people. So if it's not really in your blood, then I think a lot of people have a hard time coping with it.
A great deal of how we respond to a character on screen is a result of the costume department, which in the most basic terms provides the wardrobe for the actors. But a costume designer's job is much more than that. Wardrobe is an important way of setting the emotional scene for a movie. Trisha Biggar, who's our costume designer, she has over 80 people working for her all the time, everything from cutters and seamstresses. People like Nicole Young, who oversaw the costume fittings for actors. Michael Mooney, who makes sure that the costumes are aged and distressed as the action moves forward. The costume department's made sure that the smallest detail is never overlooked.
It looks cool, all that.
Yeah, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Gillian Libert was responsible for keeping track of all those changes in the huge sea of costumes that change with almost every passing moment of the duel on Mustafar, because virtually the whole scene is taken and shot out of sequence.
A lot of different parts and pieces go together with these costumes, and you have to make more than one, obviously, for continuity. For example, with Anakin, there was probably about 14 pairs of trousers made. There were probably 16 undershirts and 16 over jackets and 12 belts. There's just a lot of things that have to be made because it has to go through a progression. So for Mustafar, for example, in the raining lava sequence at the beginning of that scene, you know, they start off with the hero costume, which looks like this, which is pretty flawless. As the scene progresses, it looks like when the lava is actually falling on them, you know, actually burned in places and actually dirtied up. Each part of it has to have a little bit broken down to it.
Having my team with me has been fantastic. You know, I think it's fantastic that we've all been able to work on all three episodes together, and I think that shows how much we all enjoyed it.
In the strictest sense, an actor's job is straightforward: to bring the script to life. People tend to think of actors as delivering dialogue, evoking emotion through the words that they say. Hayden and Ewan had to do that, but they also had to be amazingly physical. In this sequence, their action through the duel conveys the emotion, and they spent months rehearsing it. They had to get the moves right, and they had to make us believe in the enormous emotion of the scene at the same time.
Set.
Ewan and I were constantly hitting each other, and I still have scarred knuckles from the reshoots, and Ewan the same. So the lightsabers become a liability, and so you have to be 100% present at all times when you're doing the fights.
Ewan, what if you look up at those yellow Ys? Is that where you were looking?
Yeah, no, I was looking at the white
set. Oh, all right, well, look up at the yellow Ys. Let me see what happens then.
We've had, as you say, an enormous amount of blue screen or green screen also. It seems at work in this film, and I'll never get used to that. It's really, really hard. It's fine when you're doing the fighting sequences, because really you're so focused and concentrating on the fighting, that being safe but being fast, and that really it wouldn't matter where you were.
In the end of the day, if you don't believe in what they're doing, if you don't like them, if you're not responding to the actors, you have nothing, and all this work that everybody is doing is meaningless. The stunt department designs everything from the largest action sequence to the smallest lead. Nick Gillard, the stunt coordinator on episode 3, supervises a small army of people that includes the riggers who outfit the actors in harnesses and wires, and all the stuntmen who take the place of digital characters who will be added later, and stunt doubles for all of the actors. It was really important for both George and I to bring out Nick as soon as possible. So he came about 4.5 months before we actually started shooting. I got him a very small video crew because it was very important that he did as much test footage as possible. We wanted to edit all of the sequences that he had created together with real cuts, add sound effects, and show them to George so that he could be part of the process of creating the choreography for each sequence. Nick choreographs all of these fights, and they're all character-driven. His mind is always working. How can he make each move reflect the attitude, what is happening between these two guys? And Nick has a very specific move to indicate exactly what he thinks both characters are thinking at every single moment.
It was a challenge in the Obi-Anakin fight, because 3 or 4 minutes in, you get over the initial explosion of the fight, of why they're fighting, and all the flashy moves are done. We then had to work out how you would fight somebody. It's like fighting yourself. We did loads of sections where exactly that happened, where they just couldn't get through. They just match each other perfectly.
That's good.
Yeah. That's
good. We had to build a set that would actually move and go upright. It starts horizontal and moves vertical. And the actors have to be able to act on that while it's moving. So there's a lot of interaction at the end between the floor effects people and the stunt people and Nick Gillard, the choreographer of all this. And they had to all coordinate how they were going to accomplish this with the visual effects people on how that was going to look on the screen after it was all finished.
We've got two really good stunt doubles, Nash Edgerton and Ben Cook, for Obi and Anakin, but they rarely get to work because the boys do it pretty much themselves.
For those one or two or three difficult shots that you have in the movie where they physically cannot do the shot, we let the stunt double do that, but then you have to have a scanning crew come in and they scan both actors from every single angle, and then we map on each one of the actors' face onto that stunt double.
George, as the director, oversees virtually everything. He's the captain. He steers the ship in the direction it needs to go. He's also the artist, making sure it's all coming together exactly as he imagined.
In terms of the actual shooting of it, it only took a few days to shoot that sequence. But when we get on the set, everybody is there and the expense is very high, then you have to work very quickly.
Okay, we'll try it from this side, see if I can make it work. So get right here, we should be able to catch the hit. If I can see it, then we'll be okay.
George had been thinking about the lightsaber battle for years, and his directorial team helped him realize all of his ideas.
So if anything, you'd be looking where you're going.
This whole thing's sliding.
And then you look, and you'll be going down, and he'll say hit, and then everything will jolt.
And without.
Colin Fletcher, who's our first assistant director, makes sure that everything on the set that production has given him is there for George to use at any single moment.
So, Ben, I'll be watching you for the cue of the hit.
The mood of a set is always set by the director. It is quite a quiet set, a calm set, and everyone just gets on with it, and that's George, you know.
Okay, here we go, watching.
Once we get this, we're on to the next piece.
Yep.
And also the speed, you know, the speed of the set is dictated to by him. We just basically keep up as best we can.
We may get more than this done today, but I think I'm feeling we're going to get all this stunt stuff done today, and then tomorrow morning we'll start on the coverage. But you can imagine what the coverage on this is going to be like. But anyway, we got time.
If I have any sort of changes of schedule or anything that I need to pass on to the rest of the crew, I just call Deb immediately, and her and Paul will get on the phone and just ring all the departments and say, this is what we're doing tomorrow. We're not going to stage 5, we're going to stage 6, and all that sort of thing. So it gets out to everybody really quickly. It's passing information on.
Hey, when Hayden's finished, can you ask him if he might...
They also organise all the rehearsals and all the costume fittings. A lot of the casting is done through them. So it's really, it's quite a big and important job. And Sam and Hamish stay with me on set. Basically, they're with me all the time. And when the actors are ready, Paul will send them in to us, and then it's up to us to look after them.
You might do a bit of a lean out to here. Not too much swiveling. Yeah.
Depending on what the shot is or what we need or who's required, I usually get the cast together or let the camera department know what we're shooting. If we have extras, I'll look after them as well, with how, you know, work with George, see what he wants.
They're all going to be wearing hats right now.
Yep.
The Mustafar fight was hugely complex to shoot and was shot out of sequence. That created a logistical nightmare for everyone. And our script supervisor, Jane Ann Tingren, was there to make sense of it all.
On A camera was a 4:1 zoom at 9 millimeters, distance 5 feet to 12.
She has to watch every single shot and camera setup. She has to make sure that the tiniest detail is carefully monitored and logged, from camera positions to actors' eye lines to the location of the props.
When I'm prepping the script, any questions I have regarding the timeline of the story or any continuity issues or even any character issues go straight to the director.
It came out of the script lady's notes. Who
oh, okay.
Did the
well, then. So the script clerk and the match mover coincide. My God.
We love to spar about screen direction. It's really fun. And he always wins because he's the director.
No director could do what he or she does without someone who can artistically capture the director's vision for the camera. That's the job of the director of photography and the cinematography team.
There are two scenes out here. One like this, which is sort of half in the dark and half in the light.
What we try to do is go through all of the scenes for the next week. So it really gives George an opportunity to think about his blocking, And once he's decided where everybody's going to be, then I can work on a lighting scheme.
It should go up, and it can hold for a long time because it shoots way up. So
the Mustafar scene was particularly challenging, in part because David has to be able to create a shot that will blend with effects that ILM adds in months, if not a year later. David's right-hand man is his gaffer, Eddie Knight, who's totally in charge of the electrical and lighting rigs.
And then come back up to full, please.
David, we're going to do a poor man's reverse here.
When I shoot, I have two cameras, A camera and B camera, and they are shooting either different angles. One will be tighter than the other, or they'll be shooting close-ups, one of one actor, one of the other actors. And that way I'm able to, if I get a really good performance, I'm able to use it from two different angles.
More image.
More image, that's right.
Indeed.
More pixels of the personalities.
Callum McFarlane is the camera A for Revenge of the Sith. He's aided by focus puller Matt Toll, who makes sure that the camera remains in focus whenever it moves.
Well, I was wondering if we could come out this way as far as we can, sort of swing out.
Yeah.
That's not too bad.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
The B camera team is headed by Simon Harding.
This is the B camera here. This is the B camera. Very good. And this is Toff. Please say hello, Toff. Toff's the focus puller. There's Lee. There's our clapper loader who doesn't load. You do clap, don't you, every now and again? You clap.
Where's Bretto?
I'll get him here.
There's Bretto. He's over there. Look. The dolly grip. He's cutting a fine figure in the orange T-shirt there.
Okay, here we go.
So now you've met us all. It's a wonder anything gets done, isn't it?
Here, what we try and do is make sure that I have a line of sight to the crane, so that as well as the monitor, I'm watching the crane to see out of the corner of my eye, if that's starting to move, I know I then have to compensate.
The operators of the techno crane, Jeff Brown and Mike McAuliffe, guide the camera crane's movements across the set.
And just roll cameras.
Rolling.
On episode 3, we were capturing images digitally on recording decks separate from the cameras. Fred Myers, our HD supervisor, had helped pioneer the high-definition camera technology that we used.
The images from the camera come back here to the engineering tent, and we've got a lot of equipment back here that acts as a distribution point. We create the versions of the cameras that need to go out to the plasma monitors where George is sitting. We create another version that goes out to David Tattersall at a monitor station that he has near set, and the video assist feeds as well.
Well, this is the video assist, and the video assist is a really cool job because, first of all, they can see what's going on. So we set up a bunch of monitors. We pipe the pictures to them, and we record the takes, and we play them back, and people analyze them, and we store them, we cut them, we retrieve them, and I'll have to find the shot and get it up, and, you know, that's basically what that's all about, amongst other things.
You know, especially a director like George, who likes to move quickly and is very sure of what he wants, so if he can see exactly what he's getting, then you're going to be able to move faster.
We'll try one more. That was good. I think the light cue was a little late. So we did one half, now we're gonna do the other half. That was good.
The sound crew has to make sure that the sound on the set is captured correctly and perfectly. Scene 158 in particular has no dialogue. Nevertheless, we need some sort of guide track to ensure that we can hear all the grunts which the actors will need to re-record during post-production. As our sound recordist on episode 3, that's really the job of Salty Brincat and his boom operators, Rod Condor and Nicole Miller.
You get used to it after a while. I think your arms become to a point where they're, they become numb. You start resting on your head.
We get challenges with effects of wind, etc., that actually pull us up. That's a difficulty when they want the costumes to blow in the air and the hair to move. Well, then we're sort of caught with trying to obviously just get a guide track on that in that situation.
And then there's the editorial team. They work so closely with George. This is the part that he loves the most. They have to shape the overall visual and dramatic communication of a movie, taking the hundreds of hours of footage and figuring out how to make it into a dynamic 2.5-hour movie. It's one of the most difficult tasks on any production. On episode 3, we had two editors, Roger Barton, who cut the Mustafar sequence, and Ben Burt. We kept Ben in California while we were shooting in Sydney so he could continue to work on all the animatic sequence that still needed to be filmed. But Roger was in Sydney the whole time. We were simultaneously cutting the picture while we were shooting.
Okay, cut. Thank you very much.
Once we go through the roll, we take the tape out. That's the beautiful thing about HD. It then gets copied immediately.
This is now a new negative, effectively, and this is the one that we then use in editorial, and this is, in fact, the tape that I pass on to John.
What I do is I log the tapes with all the information that I get from continuity from Jane Ann on set, as well as the camera reports. Then after it's been logged, the bin is sent across to Jet.
Then it's digitized.
I'm digitizing now, so I can pass that over to Roger.
And boom, Roger's cutting within minutes.
On traditional film shows, there would be a whole processing workflow where I wouldn't have the opportunity to screen dailies with sound until late the following day. I mean, that's a full 24-hour turnaround.
It's a fantastic way to make a movie. After the production wrapped in Sydney, Roger returned to Skywalker Ranch in California and joined Ben in an 18-month process of putting all of this footage together and refining the cut with George. Because at this point, George will start all over and build the cut from the ground up. And then there's Mike Blanchard. He's on hand to handle all the technical aspects of this really, truly intricate process.
What I'm doing here is I'm merging the two Unity systems, which is the software that we use to edit the Star Wars films. And the reason why this is so critical is that for the first time in a Star Wars movie, we had two editors working simultaneously, one in Sydney and one here at Skywalker Ranch. And so then what we had then was all the media spread out on two different places, all the clips that we would use to edit the film for the next almost 2 years spread out across two systems. Everything seems to be working perfectly. All the clips are showing, all the dailies are here, all the animatics. All we need now is George, and we're ready to go.
Okay. I like to really make the movie in the editing room. Some directors shoot the movie. I shoot around the movie.
So what I need is, I'm going to have to figure out how I'm going to do this. I think I'm going to move this down into the fight a little bit more. I think I'm going to try to stick it somewhere later in the sequence.
Collaborating with both editors, assistant editor Jet Sally organizes the thousands of shots in the movie so they're totally accessible to both editors. And working with Jet was his assistant editor, Cheryl Nardi. She's been with us for years.
It just needs MCP titles.
Okay.
The lightsaber battle was an incredibly complex task for the editors. The sequence went through different variations, or what we would call cuts, each one further refining the scene with the guidance from George.
Go on that, his swing. I see something here, which is, we have to get him to, I wonder if we go back, give me another frame on the other shot.
When you see these different cuts, you begin to understand what an amazing artistic process editing really is.
Typically speaking, the script is the Bible.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
Where'd that come from?
But in this case, the script is just a starting off point, and it's just a place where we begin our work.
We're getting there. I'm just trying to figure out where we'll do our crossover.
Right.
I mean, I think we'll put this all down as a reshoot, and I'll try to reshoot the whole thing.
The editing process is much like the writing process for George. The cut is always changing. He will take it and mold it, shape it, sculpt it as much as possible to get it to work with what he has shot. But based on what's working or not working, he likes to be able to go back and shoot. These reshoots are scheduled way in advance. The actors are contracted to return for a few days of shooting during the post-production process, in this case in London, to pick up scenes, sometimes just a single shot, or shoot entirely new scenes that weren't even conceived when we were in Sydney. This is the whole fluid aspect of what it's like to work with George.
There's too much going on that's not there. And we can kludge it like we've got now, but in order to get to the next level. We gotta have something that we can actually see.
Hey, Dan, can you cruise down for a sec?
We've got a problem. 911.
Help!
Now, at this point in the editing process, the animatics department becomes involved again.
There would be times when he would call us down to his editorial suite, just a quick meeting.
This is where we got a problem, which he might be able to help us fix. This starts to fall. They start to run. So they're over here. Mm-hmm. They're right here. Mm-hmm. And so it's the whole thing is tipping. And when it hits, we want it to kind of, you know, splash and rock a little bit to match what the next shot is. All this was before ILM even started. It's expensive shooting on the set, but it's even more expensive doing the special effects. So you really have to be very, very precise about what it is you want. I want to cut from this to a piece of volcano exploding. Do we have a good volcano eruption?
We had a very lucky break early on when we were conceiving of the whole Mustafar sequence. Mount Etna exploded. And I got a call from George over the weekend, and he said, listen, this footage is extraordinary. You gotta get on the plane. So I grabbed Ron Fricke, wonderful cameraman, and we rushed off to Italy, and within 24 hours, we actually got there, and we started filming for a week the total extraordinary footage that we have on Mustafar of the volcano planet literally exploding in front of our eyes.
Over here, I went and found all the footage that was shot, and there was plenty. He got everything, day, night. They tilted the camera so they could get as, you know, long of the eruptions as possible.
Yeah, this one. It make it the same length as that. But it would then, we turn it sideways and have it come up right in the foreground here.
Okay. What this does is it allows George to communicate an idea to his animatic department and to the guys at ILM to say, this is roughly what I have in mind in terms of composition and action. And then he'll turn to those guys and say, okay, make it 2,000% better than what Roger did, which, by the way, is not very hard.
And the previs department actually add the backgrounds into the shot so I could actually see what I was doing, because doing it in blue screen, it's very hard to get a sense of where you are and what the location is and how the action flows, how the suspense builds.
This is the animatic that came down to us. So they've obviously fleshed out the background and put the hillsides of the volcano in and, you know, made it a little more visible. And you can see the lava bed down below. So it gives a better idea. And this is all about a blueprint that ILM will use to construct the final version of the shot.
Without a doubt, Industrial Light & Magic is the premier visual effects house in the world. Every single scene of Revenge of the Sith had at least one effect, and many shots had dozens and dozens of elements. The lightsaber duel was a huge challenge. ILM had to take footage shot on green screen stages and make it appear to have been shot on a real location, a volcanic planet that really only exists in George's imagination. The visual effects producers at ILM, led by executive producer Denise Rehm, supervise all the production coordinators, the assistants, the managers who make sure that the myriad of effects departments working on the sequences come together smoothly and on budget.
There's probably 150 people working on this one sequence. It's another production happening with the same scope and scale as a live action crew.
So this time, when we open the main gate, we want to try to find a height and just hold it there, right? Okay, thank you.
You know, once I saw the storyboards and the animatics, I began formulating a plan of who I actually wanted to work on the film. John Knoll worked as long as possible by himself to create the visual effects for the film. When we decided to add a second supervisor, due to my relationship with Roger, we thought he would be a really great addition to the team.
I was very excited to be involved with Mustafar. It sounded fantastic, and it looked a real challenge. I mean, there's a large piece of work, lots of technical things, but also I just liked the look of it.
While I sort of oversee the crew, Nina and Janet handle the day-to-day production management of the sequence.
This is a list of shots we have turned over so far. Mm-hmm. So you can take a look at those specifically, and a list of just, this is from the ranch with all the shots. And this afternoon, we have the Mustafar meeting to go over the miniature shoot, to try to kind of just do a miniature shoot turnover.
I brought some more stuff for you guys to look at here.
Thank you. For the volume of work at Island, we have several producers and several people in each position, and we just run our own house from start to finish. It's, we oversee the production of many, many artists.
It's quite a logistical puzzle to try and figure out how you're going to get everything through the pipeline.
People commonly refer to us as runners. We do a lot of running around. We're basically the gophers of the crew. We do a lot of administrative office responsibilities, a lot of copying of scripts, copying of documentation. We set up a lot of the reviews and set up the dailies between the visual effects supervisors and the artists. We also are responsible for setting up the reviews between the visual effects supervisors and George over in the theater.
Whoa.
It's mind-boggling how much work goes into this movie.
Creatively, all of ILM's efforts are led by the visual effects supervisors. John was on the movie from the very beginning, working with George in the art department to create the whole master plan of Mustafar.
We have to sort of editorially put this set together somehow. Because right now it's, I mean, we have the model and we know what we're doing, but it's still pretty vague.
While I'm here, I'm working on a variety of things. You know, the main thing to do is to try and maintain quality control on blue screens and make sure we're collecting enough information to replicate the cameras later.
And they go through this.
George is very technically savvy, and his first instinct is pretty much exactly right. But a lot of times there are novel situations that come up that require some consultation. So he'll ask, should we shoot it this way or this way?
The one that's the more important is this one anyway, because it's the one that's got the most set in it.
Well, the big challenge in Mustafar is lava, and there's lots of it, and it's at lots of different scales.
Roger had a less enviable task. He came midway through the planning to supervise the actual production.
Once Roger came on, it was actually a big relief to, okay, I'm not going to think about Mustafar anymore. Now it's in good hands.
At least the stuff that that sprays up and glops over the arm to melt it, that's all going to have to be
done as a CG thing. So that's something we've already started doing, is it, John?
John Knoll essentially handed what information he had about the background of the sequence to me when I joined the show. And obviously that's a fairly daunting moment because John is so much more familiar with the whole Star Wars process. But there is that moment on the show where you sort of think, my God, what have you got yourself into?
Hey, Craig, how are you?
John and Roger also supervised hundreds and hundreds of people in many different ILM departments, each of whom had one specific task. You have to understand, sometimes you'll have an artist working on a shot, a 3-second shot, for literally months at a time. The match movers work to make sure that everyone who's associated with each shot has the visual reference points. That's an incredibly important job because a huge amount of our shooting is done against completely featureless blue and gray screen.
Whenever you want to do any kind of a 3D visual effect, be it a CG 3D element that you want to add or a miniature element from a motion control camera on stage, you need to accurately recreate the perspective and the camera angle of the shot as it was photographed originally.
In blue screen, it's very easy to get lost. It's very easy to, you know, move the camera and pan the camera or dolly or do things and not know exactly where on the fabricated set that will be there you are. So you need little markers and things in the blue screen, and there's a person whose job it is to make sure that those markers are in the right place.
As we go around, we'll have X's on one side, Y's on another, and then Z's, and try to break it up so that we have a really fast whip pan. I can see about where we are.
As the coverage gets tighter and tighter, sometimes we're into some pretty tight, you know, just a head and shoulders against the screen. If there's just nothing but an actor in blue screen, we'll want to make sure that there's some kind of reference that tells us what's panning and tilting.
These are emergency track lights that we use when we go in real tight and we can't see any of the other plastic markers that are up on the walls. By putting these track markers up, we can see how the cameras are panning around and what's happening behind the actors so that we can reproduce the camera move with the proper background.
So using the information that Jason gathered while he was on location in Sydney, we use sophisticated tracking software to recognize the X, Ys, and Zs that Jason was placing, the targets that he put on the green screen. But we then took the various measurements, photographs, camera reports, lens information, all of this stuff that he took while he was down there, and we basically rebuilt that into a virtual environment with a virtual camera move that was an exact replica of exactly what the camera move was on location. Once the original match move is completed and we incorporate into to the virtual environment, we can basically resize them to any size we want to and still maintain perspective that actually makes sense, and allowing George quite a few more options towards what the final shot should look like. We then hand that off to the other departments further down, where they will replace this kind of game res version of the Mustafar buildings with the final high res version.
One of my favorite groups is the animation department, and they're led by Rob Coleman. He's responsible, he and his team, for creating the digital characters. He has to bring them to life and make them so believable that they can interact seamlessly with our live actors.
There's 2,146 effect shots in the film. We animated 1,269 shots. Myself and others felt that it was really important that we get the feeling of that scale, of that huge thing hitting and impacting. And one of the ways to achieve that was to see it rocking, but then also to add the digital stuntman on top of that, reacting and falling and holding on for dear life, honestly.
They're fully animated. There's no motion capture in this particular shot. I kind of exaggerated it because I knew it would be fairly small on screen, and all you'd really see would be the little blue lightsabers kind of flashing around. So it had to be a broader motion than it would be if you were looking at it up close. It's maybe not the most glamorous sort of shot to do for an animator, because if we do our job right, then people shouldn't really know it's animated.
The digital environment and matte painting groups apply their artistry with computers to create entire virtual worlds, often incorporating footage we've shot in the real world, like the eruption of Mount Etna in Italy.
We're taking all of those pieces and, you know, extracting lava, extracting smoke, combining those with computer-generated images and coming up with really nice stuff.
And essentially, it's a giant backdrop, and it's going to be used for the entire Mustafar sequence. So I needed something to start with. And I actually had kind of an idea just driving to work one day, and that was I was driving past the gravel parking lot, the overflow parking lot here at ILM, and I photographed some stills of the gravel parking lot. And you can kind of see it there if we zoom in really close. And that sort of became the beginnings of the lava ocean. And once I finished the painting, then it became time to animate it. As you can see here, I've gone through and moved all the clouds as well as all of the lava ocean. It took me probably several months to actually complete the final 25,000 pixel wide painting.
If one person was working on it in a linear time frame, it would probably take him 2 or 3 years to get that work done.
The technical directors, their primary task is to light a 3D scene. That means not only lighting the objects, but creating shadows and reflections too. It's all these uses of lighting in a CG world that make it feel real and bring it to life on the screen.
We have actually two things to do. It's the lighting on it, and also the interaction with the lava, the 3D CG lava that we're going to do. What you can see here, for instance, it's like the light is moving slightly, and that was to give this feeling of the flow of the lava. So the lava doesn't have the same intensity everywhere. Also, because the lava is underneath, you want to have something that is probably brighter at the bottom and darker at the top. The lighting is important because that's what will give the shape and the density and the feeling and the mood. The lighting process will take probably about 2-3 weeks of work. Then the simulation, the particles and stuff like that, will take probably about a month.
There was a mixture of geysers. Some of the geysers were footage that we put into place from Mount Etna, and also elements that we shot on our back lot, Methasil. So here's an example of methacil being shot out of a high-pressure hose. In some cases, we were able to use the elements that we shot. In other cases, we had to generate them in CG.
We treat each ball as though it were a little density field with a high density in the middle and falling off to zero density at the outside. What we end up with is a surface. We can also use all those points as tiny little light sources to get all of the interaction with the rest of the set. And from here on, it's really just a case of layering up the detail. So I add on steam and sparks, secondary lava events in the background, debris raining down on the set. The other little detail that you can see here, but which really helps sell the final shot, is that we're getting some reaction from the arm itself. It actually bows and buckles as the lava hits it. This shot was a really strange one to work on. This was the original miniature element that we shot. We're actually looking down the river of lava and we're following the path of the arm. Unfortunately, it turned out that George had conceived the shot differently. He actually saw it as a reverse angle shot, looking back up the river, watching the arm floating down towards us. By the time we realized this, we'd actually dismantled the set. And the solution that we came up with was to, first of all, flip the plate round horizontally, run it backwards, and here you can see I've got something that just about works. Unless you look really closely, and you'll notice that the waterfalls are actually going up. It took me about 2 days to notice this. I felt really, really stupid. I was sitting there in dailies and somebody just said, aren't the lava falls going up? Sure enough, they are. Here I've done a little bit more work. I've got some more buildings here and I've got some interaction going on between the plate and the arm. One take later, you can see that we've now actually managed to get the lava falls going the right way. We've added in some background sky and layers of more stuff in from the Mount Etna footage. And a little bit more, and we get to the final shot.
The CG modelers and the view paint technicians are the digital equivalent of a construction team. They build and texture each and every single item and every single frame that we see.
This particular model took us about, I'd say, 3 to 5 weeks. We really decked this thing out for the shots because we knew we were going to see it like really close, and then we had to break the model. So what we had to do is build stuff inside the model after we break it off as well. So this is where the break point is. We added some bent pipes and stuff that goes into the model so that when it breaks off, there's actually stuff inside. And then we also built a lot of details that you probably don't see very much, but you'll probably miss it if it's not there.
You know, they really do give it their heart and soul. And a movie like this couldn't be done without that kind of attitude.
Digital technology has completely revolutionized the visual effects industry. But sometimes nothing beats the old-fashioned use of models and miniatures. And we don't always look to the future. We often look back. ILM has a substantial practical modeling group, which was instrumental in creating the Mustafar scenes.
Oh, permission to come aboard?
Yes, it's all yours.
Lava is quite a difficult thing to do inside a computer. A physical model, you can build it, you can look at it, and you can light it, and it behaves in a kind of control, a very controllable way.
And then the big structure that holds the control arms is here.
The organic nature of Mustafar and sort of the rock lava planet enabled us to build it fairly quickly.
The material itself breaks in a way like rocks do. It does that kind of thing. You can take this tool, but eventually you can make it look like a mountain. The whole set is tilted at 10 degrees. And it tilts much like a wheelbarrow, so that we can adjust the angle of it depending on how fast we want the flow.
Most of the time for Mustafar went into developing the lava and the lava crust.
Essentially, you're using a methacil, which is a food additive, and you're coloring it and underlighting it so that you have a perspex base to the river, because obviously lava emits light. And then the other thing was just the speed that the lava moved at. I looked at a lot of reference, and actually it moves at any speed you want it to. George felt initially the same way as I felt, that it should be moving slower. But when I showed him the two side by side, we were in agreement. It should be moving quickly because it just is so much more exciting.
motion control enables us to capture an environment with a camera move that can be exactly repeated over and over again. Just as in live action, we choose lenses, camera angles, filters, lighting, and effects like smoke, all to create and capture exotic worlds like Mustafar that don't exist in real life.
Sometimes it's a little more effective to go heavier smoke, so I'm just judging it by eye as I go through, and that's kind of the beauty of HD, is you see what you're gonna get as you're shooting it. It's working out great. It's really giving it some more depth and scale.
What we do is we light it in different ways, and we photograph it in different ways. So we have these component pieces, and because you're shooting it using a motion control rig, each one of the passes actually marries together. So you can mix them together. All these elements create the atmosphere and sort of ambience of the place.
ILM's rotoscope department isolates the individual elements from the green screen sets, like the actors and the props, so that they can be removed or added within specific shots.
We have very elaborate rotoscope and paint needs for the sequence, and Beth D'Amato is our roto supervisor for the sequence.
What was daunting with the Mustafar sequence was actually not so much how the work was done, but the actual quantity of work. One of the tasks that we have is to actually help compositors isolate both of the actors off of this set piece, because typically they can extract actors off of a green screen, but in this case there were a lot of shadows, and the way that their characters incorporated with our CG element, it wasn't simple enough to just pull them off of a green screen. We had to actually give them matte help. So what we do is we actually go in and create what looks like an outline or a cookie cutter shape that says all of these areas need to be isolated and physically pulled off of this element. And on top of that, both actors were carrying lightsabers, so we also had to do additional roto work to comp in lightsaber effects on every single shot. So we do a lot of paint work and we do a lot of matte work that incorporates them into an environment to make it all look real and seamless.
The compositing group brings it all together. They come in, they take all the separate elements and seamlessly blend them in to create the final shot.
As a compositor, we're basically the last ones in the chain. We get the elements from all different sources, like model elements, miniature elements. We get elements from second unit, people against blue screen, animation department. And we just combine it all to the final film frame. For this element alone, we have maybe 10 different passes. And we have, you know, the lava, we have smoke elements, different smoke elements for the foreground, for the background, and some sparks and some ambers. And it's actually a lot of fun to find the right element and make it work within your shot.
A sequence of this level of complexity takes an enormous amount of time and effort from many people that are working long hours. At the end of the day, we're almost finished here, and I still look up there and I can't believe we've done what we've done.
Sound works almost subliminally in a movie. In the best case scenario, you aren't even aware of the texture and the combinations of sounds. And yet, the sound designers think about every single shot of the movie from the standpoint of what an audience will hear.
This is audio history. I want you all to look alert. Remember, you're marching off to war, so there can be tears.
You know, Star Wars is always demanding in terms of orchestrating sound and orchestrating sound effects and dialogue with music. To construct the final sound for a one-minute section of the Mustafar sword fight, it requires work on several levels. First of all, there's just the dialogue.
You have quite a few
sword fight vocalizations in this movie, so I don't know if it's better for you to hit those at the end of our session.
One of my main responsibilities on the film is going and supervising all the dialogue, like the re-recording of the actors in the studio.
What do you think?
I mean, we could stand to have some more breaths around that, just because it's got to match in your close-up.
One of the most detailed of Matt's tasks is supervising what we call the automatic dialogue replacement, or ADR.
One of the reasons why we have to re-record a lot of the actors' dialogue that's recorded on the set is that the sounds don't sound realistic. I mean, obviously, when they're fighting with those lightsabers, that's the sound of a stick hitting, so you really hear a plastic or a wood hit. You know, and they might be walking on wood, so they're not on stone. And so all those sounds come through to the microphone, and so when they're breathing and talking, you get all these clicks and clacks. So we have to go back, and the actor has to generate that energy again. Hopefully, you're getting performances that were better than what they recorded originally on the set.
1,600 grunts and groans.
Or won't we just stand here, and you can slap me silly, and then you can just fit it in where you need to.
George, The next layer of sound was the foley, which are the footsteps and the movement. And although you may not hear a lot of that consciously, it's very important to have that there to give it a naturalness.
There was the full-time foley artist on this film, and then there were two other walkers. Basically, what our job is to really flesh out the characters. So this is what we used for Anakin, for his movement, to kind of sell his menacing character. We're using an old, just a black leather jacket that has some good creaks. We have an old rifle for some of the metallic-y sounds. And then this old drill actually too has some nice kind of sounds that we put up against it. So this all together is Anakin's sort of presence and gear.
Then you get to the actual sound effects that I design.
In addition to being one of our editors, Ben Burt designs both the overall sound experience and also specifically the environmental sounds.
The swords really don't make sound. There's really no lava. All of that has to be given weight and credibility with the sounds. Let's look at the sequence now in terms of what's really there, in terms of sound effects. Throughout this entire fight, there's an erupting volcano, so there's a roar in the back, and that roar is composed of wind, thunder that's been recorded at other times. And then there's the bubbling of all the lava. So we noticed in the lava flow in Mustafar that there's these popping bursts of lava in the flowing river of lava. So I wanted to take some explosions. Actually, there are sounds of artillery mortars firing. I'm going to mix that with a little bit of liquid water sound and blend the two together. And then we'll have a new effect which we can ship downstairs and begin to cut it in really quickly. And these liquid effects were produced here at Skywalker Ranch by putting a shovel into the mud and squeezing it and rotating it to make various bursts of mud fly in the air. And now I'm going to take those sounds and put them on a keyboard so I can play them. So there's really an array of different notes being played, all of them in the realm of continuous explosions, but with some character to them.
All the sound design elements are layered together in preparation for the final mix. Tom Myers works with Ben Burt on this monumental task. This takes months and months of work.
As the effects editor and the effects mixer, what I'm doing is cutting the sound effects and mixing as I go. For this session, this is Volcano Eruption B, which is effect number 379 that Ben has made. So just for that one scene, we have tracks and tracks of material that we go through, and at this stage what we're doing is balancing them against each other, and then we will go to the mix room and then take our balanced sound effects and put them against the balanced dialogue and the music and then balance those against each other.
Without the sound designers, the lightsabers wouldn't hum, the lava wouldn't roar, you wouldn't hear the dialogue, and the duel would be a lot less exciting. So their job is so incredibly important to the overall movie.
The sound effects need to play up the reality of lots of things. It's important in the film that if something happens, there's an appropriate sound associated with it. But also the music is the element which is abstract and can go right to the heart.
The music of John Williams and the music of Star Wars are inseparable. That is what brings the total emotional context to the movie. We were, as always, truly honored to be able to once again work with John Williams, one of the most respected film composers in the world. His score brought extraordinary depth and passion to the Mustafar duel.
Good. Good morning, people. We will start with 7M8.
Star Wars is essentially a silent movie, and in this particular case, it's even more so because it's an action sequence. There's no dialogue in it. So when I talked to John Williams, I said, listen, this is a perfect place to have a new theme. Every film, we try to at least bring in one new theme. And I said, this is sort of goes beyond the Duel of the Fates, which we used before. Because now we're, the people who are fighting are friends. So it's a kind of tragedy Duel of the Fates.
John oversees the entire process of getting the music that he's imagined inside his head out onto the screen. He and his music editor, Ken Womberg, work with a staff of orchestrators and, of course, the extraordinary London Symphony Orchestra, a group of more than 100 deeply talented musicians.
If you lift the bow on the second beat, it might be helpful.
In many ways, it's the most enjoyable part of the job because it's the moment where the music gets up off the paper, where it's just an abstraction, and becomes a live human thing.
Does it work all right?
Yeah, it works great.
With dialogue, sound effects, and all the music completed, it's the sound mixer's job to make sense of all of it. To find just the right balance so that a scene can have the maximum dramatic impact.
There's, you know, probably 200 tracks worth of material, and those are all played together through the speakers in the theater, and you make a judgment as to how the audience will hear this, and you make adjustments.
Well, I like the lava flow.
Works.
I like that part. Once he jumps off, I think we could bring the effects down just a bit. And then it's even when that thing finally hits off screen,
right,
we can bring that down too.
The idea by doing it in Pro Tools this time around is that we don't pre-mix anything. At any moment in the final mix, every sound that was recorded, the individual file, is available to us. And we can bring it up on a screen, we can re-edit the sound, we can pan it or position it around the room. And so we can address the very intricate details of the sound at any moment. This has never been done before on such a big scale.
It'd be good if we could bring that up just a bit.
It's awfully hard.
It's hard.
I think it's about as much as you can go with it. It's not a heavy band.
It's thin and weak.
Like me.
The music team hears the trumpets and the piccolos and the drums, and the sound effects team just hears the explosions and the swords. Everybody has a viewpoint, and sound is a very subjective experience. There were times when someone wasn't happy, or, you know, it usually boils down to sound effects versus music. And that means Kenny Womberg versus Ben Burtt.
You happy, Kenny?
Not really.
Not really?
No.
Why?
It's noisy.
Noisy?
Oh, I just think the music could live a little bit more than it does. I mean, it just gets wiped out.
Too noisy?
Yeah, for my taste.
We've done that for 30 years. We've had our little sparring matches back and forth at the mix.
The music is kind of a thread to that whole montage of going, cutting back and forth.
Right.
And it just gets lost.
Well, let's try lowering everything a little bit.
George, Ben, Matt, and Kenny work with the mixers to make every single sound element pull you into Anakin and Obi-Wan's world as they fight this amazing duel.
Good.
The music sounds good. Though.
Yeah, it sure does.
Are you happy, Kenny?
Yes, I'm smiling.
Really?
Is that what that is?
Now he's smiling.
All right. Well, sounds great. Sounds great.
There is a truly indescribable moment. When the group comes together, the lights go down, and the projector lights up the screen. This scene that we've worked so hard on suddenly springs to life, complete for the first time. And in that extraordinary moment, you realize how vital every single person is to getting it made. Take away any one of them, and it won't come out the best that it could be.
In theory,
thank you.
We're hoping that we're completely finished, and this is it, and we're going to say, great, and we're going to walk away. At worst, we're going to have a few notes, and somebody's going to have to scramble tomorrow and finish them before tomorrow afternoon. Because tomorrow it really is done, regardless of whether we want it to be done or not.
Yeah, a truck is stopping out front.
Yeah. And it's going to be yanked out of our cold hands.
It is such an amazing moment. It's such a real thrill to see it all come together at that final screening. See that duel, which fans have been waiting for since 1977, actually up there on the screen for the first time, is an amazing experience.
On any particular scene in the movie, it's really those hundreds of people that are the ones that are contributing to make that scene work and be as good as it can be.
And when you consider what it takes to take 1 minute of the movie, just this one little moment, then you can imagine what it takes to do 137 more. Then you have Revenge of the Sith.